Today, friends, we're talking about 2 John 9 through 11 and other scriptures, and the seven churches of Asia. We're looking at vital principles from the words of Jesus regarding the matter of fellowship in the seven churches of Asia. We know that Asia was a Roman province of the first century in what we now know as modern-day Turkey. We read in the very first part of the book of Revelation, John here in John chapter 1 and beginning at verse number 4. John to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Then we go down to verse number 11, where the seven churches of Asia are named, saying, that is, the Lord is saying here, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, and what thou seest write in a book, and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia, unto Ephesus, and unto Smyrna, and unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, and unto Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. Does Jesus Christ hate false doctrine and evil deeds? We get right into the address to the seven churches in chapters 2 and 3. And the Lord said to the church at Ephesus, but this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He also said to the church at Pergamos, so hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. Does the Lord hate false doctrine? Does he hate evil deeds? Very plainly, he does. He hates it. Was Jesus wrong for hating false doctrine? Was he mean, unloving, and unkind for saying what he did to those who were in the church? That he hated evil deeds and false doctrine. No, Jesus was never wrong. He knew no sin, 2 Corinthians 5:21. He did no sin, according to 1 Peter 2, verse 22, and many other scriptures. Will we be wrong to oppose error, to stand against those who do evil deeds and bring false doctrine, to oppose them in the Lord's church, who are teaching, practicing, or fellowshipping error? Will we be wrong if we do that? No, we can't be wrong if we follow the Lord's example. We read of Christ that he loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Hebrews 1, verse 9. We also are to abhor that which is evil and to cleave to that which is good. Romans 12 and 9. And Psalm 97, 10 commands, ye that love the Lord, hate evil. Did Jesus ever cause division? That's another question that comes up. Did he ever cause division? In John 10, verse 19, there was a division, therefore, again among the Jews for these sayings, that is, the Lord's sayings. And we read also in John 7, 43, that there was division because of him. Now, certainly, we're not so discord and bring wrongful division. But yet, when it comes to standing for the truth and doing that which is right, sometimes division will occur and often does. The truth that Jesus brought and stood for brought division. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. John 14, verse 6. The Son of God said in Luke 12, verse 51, suppose ye that I am come to give peace on earth, I tell you nay, but rather division. In other words, the effect and the result of the Lord's coming and the truth that he would bring would be division. Indeed, he is the Prince of Peace, Isaiah 9, verse 6. He is our peace, Ephesians 2, verse 14. We remember the heavenly host that praised God, saying, when Jesus was born, glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, and goodwill toward men. And certainly that is the case. When people follow the Lord and do his will, that will result. But also there is another side of it. Those who reject him and his truth, there will be division, and he does bring division in that sense. Will the truth bring division today? There's an ongoing conflict between good and evil, between truth and error, between Christ and Satan. We read, of course, the victorious note in Revelation 17, verse 14, regarding this conflict. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. So there is conflict between the Lamb of God, the Son of God, Jesus Christ, and evil who are backed by Satan. Truth is unchanging. The fact that truth is eternal implies its immutability. Peter said, "But the word of the Lord endureth forever, and this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you." 1 Peter 1, verse 25. Jesus answered Governor Pilate before his death, "Thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice." Now, heareth there doesn't simply mean that they hear him audibly, but they hear him by taking heed to his voice. And of course, the voice of Christ today is found in his word. So those who are of the truth are those who hear and take heed to the words of Jesus Christ. Now let's look at those who are of the truth. They will be hated. Jesus said to his disciples, "I have given them thy word." Well, he prays to the Father here, referring to the disciples, the 12. And of course, all who would follow him would be his disciples. But there were the chosen 12 who were his apostles. And later he would pray for all of them who would believe on him through there, the apostles' word, beginning verse 20. He said, "I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world." Now, I mentioned the young people here a while ago. This is something very important for all of us, especially younger Christians, to understand that there is a certain hatred toward those who would follow the Lord and his truth. In 1 John chapter 4, verses 5 and 6, we read of those who have the spirit of truth and those who have the spirit of error. John said, "They are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. We are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us," that is us, the apostles. "He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error." Now we see why that there are some people in the religious world, even in the brotherhood at large, claiming to be Christians, who are hearing things and following things that are not of the Lord. That is because they have the spirit of error in them and not the spirit of truth. Only those who have the spirit of truth are those who will heed only what the Lord says through his holy word. The words of Jesus to his apostles in John 15, again solidifying the point that there is going to be conflict between the world and those who would love and follow the truth of our Lord. Jesus said, "If the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me." Now here's the reason. They do not know God. And that is why they will hate you and why they will hate the truth. Now, did the Lord have anything against the church at Thyatira? We turn to the second chapter of Revelation, verse 19. The Lord commends them for various things. He reveals himself as the Son of God. There as he begins his address. But then in verses 20 and 21, he said, "Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee. Because thou sufferest, that is, you are permitting, you are allowing, that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. And I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not." Yes, the Lord did have something against the church at Thyatira. Why did the Lord rebuke them? They were tolerating, that is, suffering and permitting sin in the church at Thyatira. That's why he had things against them. The text does not say that they were all practicing Jezebel's sin. Now, this is a significant point here. But still, they were commanded to repent. He said, "Repent or else I will come to thee quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth." Verse 16. Although not all were teaching what Jezebel taught or doing what she was seducing certain ones to do, who were said to be committing fornication with her symbolically in that they were participants in her sin, they were still rebuked very sternly by the Lord because they were allowing Jezebel to persist in her sins within the congregation. Why? They were tolerating that which the Lord hates. That's what he had against them. Therefore, those who tolerate and thus uphold that which Christ hates need to repent. It's very plain. Was Christ in fellowship with Jezebel? Let's look at that question. No, because the Lord was against her evil teaching and her evil deeds. I'd like to go ahead and read here, then also verses 22 to 24. The Lord said, "Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds." That is, they were said to commit adultery with her. And of course, we know that the word adultery is used figuratively in the New Testament as well as literally to refer to the physical act of adultery, but also spiritual adultery, such as in James 4:4. Those who love the world are adulterers and adulteresses. Now, we know that includes physical adultery, but it includes much more. Anytime one is unfaithful to the one who is the bridegroom of the church, Jesus Christ, that person is committing spiritual adultery against his or her Savior. That is, any member of the church. He said, "I will cast her into a bed and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And I will kill her children with death." We understand this to be her followers, those who were heeding her false teaching and her seductions. "And all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and the hearts, and I will give unto every one of you according to your works. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan, as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden." If those at Thyatira did not repent of their fellowship with Jezebel, they could not continue in fellowship with God. That's very plain. Jesus said, and we just read this, how that he would cast into a bed them that commit adultery with her and into great tribulation. We also notice here in the text in verse 21 how that the Lord gives space for repentance. He gave that space, that time and opportunity to Jezebel to repent, but she repented not, according to verse number 21. And then we know today that that space eventually runs out. What if the Christians at Thyatira refused to repent and continued in fellowship with Jezebel? Would they have been in fellowship with God? No, because we are to have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them, Ephesians 5 and verse 11. Is it possible to have fellowship with light and darkness at the same time. According to 2 Corinthians 6, verse 14 and 15, the American Standard Version, Paul wrote to the church of Corinth, "Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness and iniquity, or what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial, or what portion hath a believer with an unbeliever?" Obviously, one cannot have fellowship with light and darkness at the same time. Therefore, the Thyatiran Christians could not have had fellowship with darkness and light at the same time, and neither can we. Is it possible to be in fellowship with darkness and with God? No, because God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. In 1 John chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, "This then is the message which we have heard of Him and declaring to you, that God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with Him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But," verse 7 says, "if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanseth us," that is, continuous action, keeps on cleansing us from all sin. That is, upon the condition that we're in the light with the Lord, then we have fellowship with God and His continual cleansing of the blood of His Son. We know there are several passages in 1 John that indicate the same thing, such as chapter 2, verse 3. "And hereby we do know that we know Him, if we keep His commandments." This is the same as walking in the light. If the Thyatiran Christians continued in fellowship with Jezebel, what if that was the case? Then they would have been in violation of God's law on fellowship. We know that from the passage that we just read from 1 John chapter 1, but what about 2 John 9 through 11? "Whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. If there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. For he that biddeth him Godspeed is partaker of his evil deeds." I believe last night one of the brethren brought out that being a partaker of his evil deeds, that can include several things. And not just, of course, receiving one into one's house, but financial support, holding up a false teacher as a faithful teacher, or going and supporting them and encouraging their work. There are several ways that we may bid Godspeed to a false teacher. But in so doing, one becomes a partaker of the evil deeds of that false teacher. Therefore, the Thyatiran Christians, if they had refused to repent, would be in sin and out of fellowship with God, because God is not in fellowship with darkness. And those in fellowship with darkness and those in fellowship with darkness cannot be in fellowship with Him. We see that very plainly. Consequently, other churches of Christ would be forbidden to have fellowship with the church at Thyatira as long as they fellowship Jezebel, because we are to have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, Ephesians 5, verse 11. It's very plain, isn't it, brethren, to understand? But now let's go further in making applications. What if the Thyatirans refused to repent? They would have been in darkness, and therefore other churches of Christ could not have scriptural fellowship with them. They could not have scriptural fellowship with them if they refuse to repent of their fellowship error. What if the Philadelphian Christians, and by the way, there are only two congregations among the seven churches of Asia, the church at Smyrna in Revelation 2 and the church of Philadelphia in chapter 3, who were not commanded to repent. These were faithful congregations. But we're just presenting a what-if situation. What if the Philadelphian Christians had gone ahead and fellowshipped the Thyatirans anyway? What if that was the case? They also would have been in fellowship in violation of God's law and fellowship. They would have been in transgression of that, because we cannot have fellowship with light and darkness at the same time. 2 Corinthians 6, verse 14 and 15. Then the Philadelphians also would have been out of fellowship with God. Why? For God is not in fellowship with darkness. And those in fellowship with darkness cannot be in fellowship with him. And we've already cited these scriptures. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. 1 John 1, verse 5. Now, what if? What if the church at Smyrna had opposed the error of Jezebel, and therefore also opposed the fellowship that the Thyatiran congregation was having with her? What if? What if the Thyatirans refused to repent and all the churches of Asia continued to fellowship them anyway? Would the church at Smyrna be in error for opposing all of them? Can you see the application for today? Would the church at Smyrna be in error for opposing all the congregations who continued in fellowship with the church at Thyatira who refused to repent of her fellowship with error? Would the church at Smyrna be in error for such opposition? Would the church at Smyrna be obligated to oppose all of those in fellowship error? Not only are we allowed to have such opposition toward error, we are commanded to do so. Ephesians 5:11, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them, that is, expose them, and show their error and stand against them. What is the church at Smyrna to do? Let's take a little quiz here, a test. What is the church at Smyrna to do? Multiple choice. A, give in and not oppose the Thyatirans because they have been a good congregation in the past. Think about that option. B, give up because they would not be able to fellowship any congregation in Asia if they continue their opposition to these brethren and their practices. So just give up. Is it C, repent because the preachers and elders at Thyatira and other congregations have condemned them for their stand? I think some of us here can feel the pinch of that, can't we? Amen. Or is it D, continue to stand firm against false doctrine and unscriptural fellowship practices? We're not finished though. What about E, oppose the error of Jezebel, but continue in fellowship with the church at Thyatira and others who are upholding them? Before we give the answer, I want to look at Proverbs 17:15. He that justifieth the wicked, and he that condemneth the just, even they both are an abomination to the Lord. What is the answer according to the Bible? D, continue to stand firm against false doctrine and unscriptural fellowship practices. Not asking for a show of hands, but did all of us choose that answer? We should have. Hopefully, if we didn't get it right after this lesson, we will get it right. Why? Because we ought to obey God rather than men. Acts 5, verse 29. Why? We cannot please God if we refuse to oppose error or darkness. I'd like to go back to another passage here in Revelation 2, and this is to the church at Pergamos. I know one of our good brothers is going to deal with that later, but I just want to prove the point here that they also were rebuked for tolerating error. Verse 14 and 15. But I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel to eat things sacrificed unto idols and to commit fornication. So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. So they were rebuked for tolerating error also. Why? Because we cannot oppose error and at the same time line up with those who are sponsoring, fellowship, or upholding error. Now, friends, you would think that men who have written books in the brotherhood and who are teachers or have taught in preacher training schools and preached the gospel for many years, and the elders who've been in the church for many years would understand that, wouldn't you? You would think they would understand it. I really don't think it's because they don't understand that. Right. Because they don't want to, for money or prestige or positions in the brotherhood or whatever. Because compromise of the error of sin, that's another reason that we must do what this says here. Continue to stand firm against false doctrine and unscriptural fellowship practice. Which I am thankful to say that this congregation here and various congregations represented and preachers here and elders here are doing that. But let's keep on, brethren. Let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap, if we faint not. Galatians 6, verse 9. What did Proverbs 23:23 say? Buy the truth and sell it not. Don't sell out the truth for any price. The money trail, preaching opportunities, prestige, position, or a big name, so to speak. But you know, there's only one really big name in the brotherhood. And that's the name in which there's only salvation, the name of Jesus Christ. Acts 4, verse 12. In the true brotherhood. Another reason, because if we do not have fellowship with God and His Son, Jesus Christ, no other fellowship is worth anything. John said, and this is life eternal, that we might know Thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom Thou hast sent. John 17, verse 3. Now, it does not matter who or how many are in fellowship with error. We will only be in fellowship with God if we oppose all error, even if all other area congregations or the majority of the brotherhood are in fellowship with error or darkness, Ephesians 5:11. Doesn't matter who or how many. Even if all the others oppose Smyrna, they still would have God for standing up for Him. We will still have God when we stand for Him. Is God's law and fellowship part of the doctrine of Christ? Yes. We cannot oppose any of God's teaching, either by inaction, that is negligence or a failure to do it, or actively, as those who teach against the Lord's doctrine and overtly oppose it, and remain right with Him. We remember that from 2 John 9. Now, let's think about the logic of this, that whosoever goeth onward, that is, transgresses and abides not in the doctrine of Christ, hath not God. Now, God's law and fellowship is part of the doctrine of Christ. So if we have a brother or a congregation that does not continue standing for the Lord's doctrine in that matter, have they not gone onward and transgressed the doctrine of Christ and lost God? Of course they have. They have. Are those who disregard or oppose this law abiding in the doctrine of Christ? No. Obviously then, they do not have God, according to 2 John 9. Whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. Fellowship with God must be maintained at all costs. That which we have seen and heard, John writes, we declare unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. The fellowship with us, with the apostles, is for those who are faithful to the apostles' teaching, which was revealed to them by the Holy Spirit, and it is namely the doctrine of Christ. It's called the apostles' doctrine in Acts 2:42 because they were the ones who conveyed it to men. But we must abide faithfully in that if we are to have fellowship with God. We read of God's goodness there in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse number 9. I like to read that. That's a very important scripture on fellowship. God is faithful, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Isn't God's faithfulness great that we could be in fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord? Even if it means we stand alone, we must maintain fellowship with God. Let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 4, 16 to 18. Paul speaking here, even if it means we stand alone, if the Lord is standing with us, that's the important thing. Paul said, at my first answer, that is my first defense, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear, and I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. And the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Also, even if it means opposing loved ones and longtime members of the congregation, we have to stand with God. Even if it's our father or mother or son or daughter. Jesus said, he that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. Matthew 10, verse 37, 38. Even if it means that our brethren turn against us. Go to 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 15. You remember all the great work that Paul did in Asia in Acts chapter 19? And how many souls that he taught and converted to God and to the way of salvation? He wrote to Timothy these very sad words near the close of his life. This thou knowest, that all they which are in Asia be turned away from me, of whom are Phygellus and Hermogenes. Jesus warned, and fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Matthew 10, verse 28. You know, the wise man said that the fear of man bringeth a snare. That is so true for us and for many brethren who have given in to pressure and compromise. They've fallen into the snare and the trap of the devil because they have allowed the fear of man to overtake them. But the Lord said that we are to fear God and not man. Can those who bring a false doctrine be in fellowship with God? Well, we've already seen that those who transgress and go onward from the doctrine of Christ, his teaching, which, again, I'll say amen with Brother Hatcher, is the totality of the New Testament. It's not just as the liberals and the change agents say, and their reason for this is to broaden the circle of fellowship. They say it's just the doctrine about Christ. But it is the doctrine that emanates from him, the New Testament, all of it. Again, we see that if there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. For he that biddeth him Godspeed is partaker of his evil deeds. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 3 to 5, Paul said, if any man teach otherwise and consent not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing, but doting about questions and strifes of words, whereof cometh envy, strife, railings, evil surmisings, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness. From such withdraw thyself. Can those in fellowship with false teachers be in fellowship with God? Can we be in fellowship with those who uphold brethren, who fellowship that which God hates? Not according to 2 John 9 to 11, though he have gone on from the doctrine of Christ. Can we be in fellowship with those who ignore God's law and fellowship? And this includes many brethren. And how to deal with those who are not abiding in the doctrine of Christ? We are not only told not to have fellowship with them, we are told to deal with them. We are to deal with them. We are to oppose them. Again, going back to 2 Titus chapter 1, to the young preacher Titus, Paul said, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole houses, teaching things which they ought not for filthy lucre's sake. We must oppose them. Can we, my brethren and friends, compromise the truth without eternal consequences? Jesus said, he that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. John 12, verse 48. And I want to close with Galatians chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. Here Paul has reference to the Judaizing teachers seeking to bind circumcision on New Testament, new Gentile converts to Christ. He said in verses 4 and 5, and that because of false brethren unawares brought in, there's the Judaizers, who came in privily despite our liberty which we have in Christ Jesus, that they might bring us into bondage, to whom we gave place by subjection, no, not for an hour. We did not compromise with them, no, not for an hour. Why? That the truth of the gospel might continue with you. And that, my beloved friends, is one among many other important reasons that we cannot afford to compromise and to give in to falsifiers and compromisers and false teachers, no, not for an hour, that the truth of the gospel might continue with you. Thank you very much.